Malaysia is a claimant country when it comes to some territories in the South China Sea. How would you approach this problem, considering that the Philippines has had a UN arbitral victory ruling, and yet China refuses to acknowledge it? We're experiencing incidents in the West Philippine Sea, in our own exclusive economic zone.
Precisely because of this concern that I raised the subject with Pastor Bombong, and we did suggest that we should explore more high-level sessions within ASEAN so that we take a common position. Well, the Chinese are willing to discuss, and that is certainly positive as far as I'm concerned. Not easy resolution, but we must secure some sort of a basic understanding among ASEAN vis-a-vis China.
Did you discuss partnerships in terms of joint patrol, defense partnerships, when it comes to the South China Sea issue?
Well, we've not come to that stage, but the understanding is there, particularly between Malaysia and the Philippines. But our Navy need to be further enhanced. The capability is not as strong as we expect, as even compared to Indonesian Navy or the Filipino.
Would U.S. presence help in the region? Interestingly, wrote a book, The Asian Renaissance, that actually covers Asia's independence from the West. It's that journey. And yet, considering the influence of China today, do you believe that U.S. presence in the region would help?
Well, we have never argued against U.S. presence, although military presence, our view is it should be avoided because that would then provoke and escalate tension. But we want to preserve ASEAN as zone of peace and neutrality and freedom, of course. So which means we will have to continue to engage with the Chinese and with the U.S. But it will be disconcerting if any force, east or west, starts showing the military might or presence within ASEAN. And that we have to strongly guard ourselves.
Would you want ASEAN to speak in a more decisive voice when it comes to the South China Sea issue?
Well, we have to take a common position and then engage with the Chinese, because if we take too combative a view, it will not resolve. It will not ease the tension. So I think let us start with the first option, to get the consensus within ASEAN and take a position with the Chinese to suggest that these are our concerns. And I think the best route is to get into amicable resolution to this. I don't believe that we need to be too combative with our neighbors, because even among ASEAN, we have never been combative, although there were some issues affecting the border, territory, but we have already maintained that sort of a reasoned and calm attitude, excepting for Myanmar, of course.
You've also discussed Myanmar with President Marcos Jr. Right now you're experiencing a refugee crisis. What would you want your Asian neighbors to do more when it comes to the crisis?
Because 4 decades of constructive engagement has not been meaningful. People are still being killed, and hundreds and thousands are leaving or forced to leave. Their villages and houses are being burnt. We have 200,000 refugees from Myanmar, mainly from Rohingya, in Malaysia. And we can't say it is purely an internal issue. So I have appealed to friends in ASEAN to say, look, we have to be tougher. How? I think, of course, my senior partners must also help engage more effectively and probably be more assertive. And if necessary, engage with the armed forces of these countries, because sometimes the military junta do not understand probably the civilian sort of narrative.
But what's difficult is Malaysia's bearing the brunt of the immigration problem.
And that's why I suggested to President, I said, okay, you know, and why do I take a relatively stronger position? Because it's affecting our country. It's not small. And of course, the atrocities cannot be condoned. I mean, how do you expect me of doing through all this human rights abuse and violations and suddenly keep silent and completely ignoring or oblivious to the stark realities? So I think it's both from the personal experience point of view, from the general policy of the Malaysian government, but we'll have to find an amicable resolution, which is difficult right now because they have tried all. We don't want other forces and countries to be involved. So ASEAN has to prove that it is relevant and able to at least ease some of the problems.
Is it difficult or different for you now? You used to be an opposition leader. Now you're prime minister of a country. Clearly, you'd have to compromise one way or another with your own values. Do you see that as a challenge?
Yes, it is. Frankly, it is, because there are things that you have to be more cautious or circumspect in expressing your views. I tend to joke with my foreign minister because every time I speak off the cuff, he gets a bit nervous. I understand, of course, but I think generally, of course, because we are living in a multilateral relationship. Yes. And therefore, they must be. But certain fundamental principles must be at least accepted. That's why I'm known to be a resilient, because other than fundamental issues, issues of ethics, issues of justice, issues of morality, cannot be compromised too far, because otherwise then you are degrading the human values.
Many don't know that you were once a Rizal scholar. Is that accurate?
Well, I mean, I'm a student of...
But what is it about Jose Rizal, our national hero? What is it about his life that you can relate with so much?
Well, he is a tragic life, not only a national hero. I consider him precursor of Asian Renaissance. He talks himself as a wanderlust Malay. He talks of the region very comfortably, and he comes about not only just as a freedom fighter in a sense, but is also the philosophical construct about the strength of the indigenous values, the rejection of this colonial mindset of condescending towards the colonized. Touching on fundamental values like justice and compassion and tolerance, which is so critical.
Do you see yourself as a Jose Rizal-like? Do you have the same characteristics, do you feel?
Well, there's a huge gap between these personalities. but of course, I've read most of his works, and some, including Nolimi Tangere, has been translated into Bahasa, the national language. I used, even in the University of Philippines lecture, the indolence of the Filipinos, because that gives really the spiritual strength of the Filipino nation against the might of the colonizers. And only through indigenous resolve that you can, dignity, you can actually free the society and move forward. So I think in that sense I'm a resilient, but otherwise I'm a small fry.
No, but clearly you know about Philippine history. It's close to your heart in one way or another. And Sabah has been a part of the Philippines history. And you spoke about it with President Marcos Jr. in 2018. That's the irony of it all. Did you talk about it now?
Well, I mentioned it because, you know, it's quite contentious, because the position of the Philippines and, you know, the historical antecedents in Malaysia, Sabah is part of Malaysia, we are very comfortable with it. But I think to be fair to the Filipino position, they have not taken a very extremely hostile or aggressive stance. So let this evolve. Slowly, although it is tough for us, because our people in Sabah feel that, you know, we should be more assertive in defending. But I think the president has been very cordial in the sense that, you know, that's the Filipino position, that's the Malaysian position. But let it rest for a while. It should not be an issue that would be easily provoked or cause antagonism, because there are too many things in common, and these are two great nations. They must work together. I represent this generation, and I told the president very clearly that let us work together to enhance these bilateral relations, as had never happened before.
Another interesting point is just February last year, before you actually took your oath as prime minister, a French arbitration court ordered the Malaysian government to pay $15 billion to Selu claimants of Filipino descent. And I'm curious, how will your administration deal with this? Do you even respect that ruling?
We have won subsequent cases. I mean, this is some claimants on an individual basis. The Philippine authorities have not been involved in any manner. They've got to solicit some professional counsel from the UK, taking a certain cutback. So I don't think it is a decision that would affect the sovereignty of nations. To us, it's our national sovereignty. There are, of course, contentious issues regarding interpretation of agreements, which we can resolve. I don't think I'm hard and fast on that. But to give this ridiculous, frivolous claims, there were faults in our legal process, but then it's been corrected, and I think we'll continue to win the cases.
You're hitting 100 days in office, interestingly, this week as Prime Minister. What would you say is your biggest achievement in the last 3 months? I know it's too soon, but I guess short-term, low-lying fruit, what would it be?
You know, 2 weeks, 100 days, to me it is inconsequential, because of course this is mainly the legacy of American administration, policy, particularly I think from the days of Roosevelt. But I think what was important from the first day was your message. Good governance in the country. Rid the country of corruption. Get a clear framework in what development means. We cannot ignore and marginalize some segments of the community to remain abject, poor, and to allow for such gross disparity from the very rich and the very poor. And the country must be free, must free itself from endemic corruption. Malaysia should not be known because of these various past scandals. So I think from day one, I give that strong message. I make clear that no way will I compromise on this. So I think that to me, whether it's 1 day or 100 days or 100 years, we must begin now, and we have done so.
Let's start with that, since you mentioned corruption, the one MBD scandal. Sadly, Malaysia has been coded all over the world because of a sovereign wealth fund gone wrong, right? And you've demanded Goldman Sachs to already pay off. Where are you now with that? Where is Goldman Sachs?
You see, as I've said, this sort of treacherous deals and of course absconding sovereign funds could not have happened if this national system, with judicial independence, professional prosecution, and independent institutions, central banks, etc., had been intact. And there are some flaws, but it could not have happened in that scale if the international financial institutions like Goldman Sachs is not complicit to the crime. So it's a tough stance. And we cleared it to the Goldman Sachs. And it's not right for you to say now we'll pay you some minor compensation. Yes, it was done by the past, the previous administration, which I think was clearly not complicit, but at least certainly didn't focus on these issues, and I've changed. I've dismissed the legal team and the entire team, and work again, because I think I owe it to the Malaysian people. I mean, why do we need to pay billions of dollars to the complicit crime of others? So I take that position, and we are reopening, of course, the case and negotiations with Goldman Sachs. And they can't say, well, it's over. No, it's not over. Mm. Yeah, 2 days back, we settled with Abu Dhabi Investments, the IPIC in London, and we obtained $1.8 billion, which is a major success. I mean, we thank to the not only the team, but also the Abu Dhabi authorities for trying to resolve it amicably and move on. But only through leadership with integrity, if you don't have any side deals, can you regain what was lost.
Now, Malaysia's also sued JP Morgan and Deutsche Bank. Are you willing to negotiate with these two banks? Come up with a settlement too?
Yes, even with Goldman Sachs. It is better if they can come up with some reasonable proposals that we can adjust, other than having to be dragged to court for years. I mean, I am in favor of quick resolution. If we can get some of the returns, we may not get 100%, but it must be a fair deal. You know, these financial institutions with all so-called experts cannot be complicit, and they cannot just let be squat free without taking some responsibility for the misdeeds and malfeasance.
You've always led in an argument of righteousness and justice, anti-corruption, even when you were an opposition leader. And in some of the interviews I've seen, they've also brought up issues about you working with your deputy prime minister, who's charged with 47 counts of corruption. You're also accused of nepotism. How do you balance this now?
It's not balance. We had to form a coalition. Any party, in order to form government, will have to enter into a coalition process. Now, the president of the party, who is now deputy prime minister, has been charged for some technical offences. I don't understand why it is 47. Clearly, it's also questionable how it's being done. But nonetheless, I said, it's not my issue. We have to respect due process. He has not been convicted. He has alleged that this is malicious prosecution, but I have advised him to go through the process. I have not interfered. So what's the issue? Oh, the opposition says, well, because of the fact that he's being charged. I said, well, let's look at the record of this opposition who were then in government at that time. And the complicity with many of the corruption cases sometimes far exceed that. So let us then go through the process. Let the Anti-Corruption Commission conduct the affairs. Then if the Attorney General decide to prefer a charge, then they will have to answer in court. But what we cannot compromise is interference with the judicial process. Now, it should nepotism because they brought up, I wanted my daughter to just advise me pro bono. I said, what is important in the country is governance, that you do not interfere in the contracts, you do not take money, and you do not squander money. And it is appalling. I mean, for people having the corrupt who have taken billions, who have appointed their son and their son-in-laws and given hundreds of millions of contracts, to have the audacity to come back and say, well, this is not nepotism. I mean, this, but notwithstanding, because of the perception, my daughter then opted to resign, you see, which is unfortunate because in this field, she has taken a strong stance. But, this perception is important. And they say part of good governance, what I have talked about, good governance and anti-corruption and against nepotism, fair. But nepotism is appointing people and squandering and influences policies at the expense of the state.
You have had a stellar life. Your political journey is short of miraculous, one would say. You've been incarcerated twice for charges that other people can't even imagine that would fall into their own lives. How could you be here right now and not be bitter, not be angry, still smiling and run the country?
Karen, you were, of course, familiar with the case. You were there.
Absolutely.
Since 1999, interviewed my wife, and you understand the predicament. It wasn't easy. Prison is not bed of roses. I mean, it's not twice, three times. Even prior to that, I was also detained because of the student demands, protests against the treatment of the poor farmers in the north. But between your personal predicament and the nation, the nation takes precedence. Mm. And we have to move on. I mean, people do make mistakes, but they should not repeat it. Now that I'm in charge, I said, I will not tolerate this nonsense. Mm. Whatever they say, they accuse me in terms of governance, we have to save the country and now Malaysia to re-emerge as a vibrant economy, as a nation, mature democratic society.
Mm. What do you think did being in jail with those trumped up charges, that kind of political harassment, what did that teach you that's helping you become the leader you are today?
Wiser and older, unfortunately. No, I think, Aaron, what I did was a lot of time to reflect. You meditate at the same time. Mm. You keep yourself healthy, not out of choice, because they don't give you enough sugar. Mm. No meat.
This one, no meat?
One wow. year was no yeah. meat.
Wow.
Right. So your cholesterol level is very yeah. low, controlled.
Yeah.
Sugar is very well, yeah. Controlled. Mm. So there's also the positive side of the imprisonment. But you spend a lot of time, mm. hours and hours, 8 hours, 10 hours a day just reading whatever I can find. The classics, the philosophy, the religious texts, and great.
Mm. And I have to ask this because you have such a unique relationship with former Prime Minister Mahathir. You were once his prodigy, and then until it turned sour at one point. What's your relationship like today? Do you talk to each other?
No, we are not in communications as much, but I think we have to move on. Mm. I don't have an issue against yeah. him. It is he who sacked me.
Yeah.
He put me into prison, and I got tortured when he was Prime Minister.
Have you forgiven him? How could you
move? He reneged on the promise,
yes.
Which is a major surprise after all that's happened, and we have forgiven and moved on. I said, it's immaterial whether I forgave him or not. I just want to move on. He's 97. I think he has to move on and make sure he has good health and peace of mind. Mm. But my task is horrendous, having to repair all these past excesses. And I think it would be good for me, Aziza, the family, and the nation, if we have a leader who's fully occupied just about helping the nation grow.
Mm-hmm. Two last questions for you. I know they want me to wrap up. You're 75 years old. You look great. What's the secret? No, really?
A doctor wife who's strict with the diet.
Okay.
No, not... I don't know. I mean, I tend to have a good regular exercise, have a good, diet. Oh, I can't do it in Manila. You've been serving me too good food. But
really, what moderation. Do you do?
In moderation. In moderation. Mm-hmm. I try to catch up with good sleep, which I fail, of course. But I'm lucky. Mm.
My last question is, very few people get to your position. All over the world, you have very few personalities that are almost revered, right? Nelson Mandela, at one point, Aung San Suu Kyi. How do you not lose the Anwar Ibrahim that the world knows? The compromise is tempting along the way. Then you can lose it all. Mm. The reputation you've built, the admiration of the world. What do you do?
Well, you have to draw the line. Of course, there are a lot of compromises. Given a choice, I would have done better in many other ways. But I think that you draw the line. For example, governance on the issue of poverty, on the issue of anti-corruption. I think if you draw that line, you will be able to succeed. I think, and not too obsessed about what others think, you know, like most politicians do, having to be excited about any every time there's a poll, okay? But just do what is right. I think that's important. Yeah, and finally, I believe, we say inshallah, God willing, if you do what is right, then there is that satisfaction, spiritual, mental, that you know you do your best. It wouldn't satisfy everyone in the days of social media. Mm. You know, it is not easy, but I'm generally a happy person. I mean, I'm relaxed, I'm happy, I don't get too engrossed with all these problems and details. You know why? Because I went through hell already. Mm. So it's not going to be worse than what I had experienced.
On that note, Mr. Prime Minister, what an honor to be speaking with you, sir.
Thank you.
Really, what an honor.